Hello, I'm Stan Grant. Welcome to Awaken, coming to you from East Arnhem Land at the Garma Festival. This week, of course, Australia has been shocked and outraged by the abuse of children in detention in the Northern Territory. But now even efforts to try to come to grips with this issue have run into problems. The Royal Commission was called, but now the Royal Commissioner himself has stood down. Two new commissioners appointed. But what does this mean for Aboriginal people who represent more than 90% of those behind bars in juvenile detention? I sat down with a special panel to look at how we got here and what some of the answers may be.
Bunduk Marika, a community local land owner and artist and environmentalist. Nice to have you with us. Jackie Huggins, co-chair National Congress. Vernon Petullo, the director and chairperson of North Australian Aboriginal Justice Agency. Muriel Bamblett, CEO of Victoria Child Welfare, and Yaraman Kanol, a youth activist here. Yaraman, I might just start with you, actually. As a youth member here, looking at what we saw on our screens this week, what impact did it have on you?
Honestly, I have been really traumatised by the whole event. You know, that could have been any one of my friends, you know. I think that the state that we're in right now with, you know, with regards to Indigenous youth, we're at a crisis point. And I think that, like, personally, I haven't watched the whole Four Corners, you know, episode because it just hits too close to home. I know so many friends, so many family members who have, you know, youth in incarceration. And I think that this is a turning point. You know, we know that it's been happening for so long, but the fact that it's been, you know, put on, you know, national TV and really the whole of Australia has seen it, I think that we need to keep that momentum going because we can't just let this, you know, die down.
Bunduk, Australia's been shocked by this. There's been outrage. And yet, amongst our people, we know that this is sadly predictable and that we have seen these things before. You actually heard about this when someone contacted you, didn't you, and said, have you seen this? Did you know about this? What was your first reaction?
As long with the nation, and in particular the Northern Territory, I was shocked and astounded that something like this would be happening right in our front doors. That sometimes for a parent, grandmother, or a family member is a hard thing to get over mentally.
And you know of personal cases where people have been through this very institution, and you've seen the impact, haven't you? How do people, young people, come out of an institution like Don Dale? What impact have you seen it have on them?
I think when you trust the system and you agree with the system that there's perpetrators or lawbreakers, like in traditional Aboriginal law, are to be punished. So trusting the system, you bring the child to justice, which is the process of the child going through interviews, then ending up at court, and then finally, if they're found guilty, ending up in a place like Don Dale.
But this was a breach of trust, wasn't it?
It was a breach, literally a breach of trust, yes.
Vernon, is that the way you see this as well, that there may be processes in place, there may be instances where people need to be dealt with, but there are also limits to the way people can be treated? Did you feel the same breach of trust here?
Yeah, look, quite clear. There is obviously a big breach. If there was any trust there, you know,
there's a
question,
with.
I guess.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, look, the people going there, they've got enough problems on their mind as it is. And, you know, some people perhaps go in there and maybe, you know, relying on a bit of trust and a bit of help and come out, you know, a lot more worse. And for those young kids that are going in there, a lot of them, you know, they're not too bad, you know, they just need a little bit of support. But none of that system is in place currently, just doesn't support nobody, particularly the young kids.
And Jackie, as I said to Bunduk, yes, there is shock and outrage, but there's also a sad familiarity to so much of this, isn't there?
Absolutely, Stan. For many of us who've been around Aboriginal affairs for quite some time, We've heard the stories.
We've heard it from our parents. We've heard it from our grandparents.
We did indeed. And this has been something that wasn't new to us. You know, I was outraged and I was sickened. I sat before the television and it was all surreal in terms of what they were doing and the punishment that was applied and the violence that was applied to those young men.
And it's the sound. We can all remember the scream.
Yes.
And the sound and the violence. You're right, the violence of this scene. Mm. This was a violent scene.
Yes, look, it was like out of a horror movie, really. Mm. And it could have been any one of our sons, our nephews, and grandsons as well. So I think it really spoke to the core values and the core issues that we face within our communities as Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people today. We only need to look at the Royal Commission to Aboriginal Deaths in Custody. Mm. You know, we commemorated 25 years of that. It came and it went. Not many of the recommendations have been implemented.
In fact, and the imprisonment rate has doubled, increased by 100%.
The prison rate has doubled. You know, in the past 10 years, 88% has been accorded to the increase in the incarceration rates of our people. For Aboriginal women, it's worse. Aboriginal women are the fastest growing prison population in our country, and if not, the world. So, alarming statistics. Why aren't we doing something about it? We're pretty powerless in that sense, but why aren't governments and the system doing something?
And Muriel, that's a question, isn't it? And you work in this directly, you work with youth. This question of why. Why isn't something being done? How do we get to this point? And why do we have to be shocked and outraged all over again to finally wake up the nation that something needs to be done?
I think you only have to look at other reports. The Little Children, a sacred report. And a number of years ago, I was involved in the anti-inquiry into the child protection system then. And it absolutely, you know, to me was no shock to see this, because you can see failings of the system to protect the most vulnerable. You can see failure to provide, you know, services to young people that are hungry, you know, services to address the real issues. And I think that there are no real Aboriginal responses to in the Northern Territory. And I think you've got a system that doesn't hear the voice and come to the community and look to responses from the community. And I think that other states use the Koori courts. They have Aboriginal responses. And I think, you know, the Northern Territory, and I've read, you know, quite a few reports, and constantly the Aboriginal community puts to the Northern Territory government solutions on a way forward, and they get rejected.
And you know, we're reminded again this week that this is something that exists within politics and also above politics, that that politicians of various stripes have been directly responsible for this and share in the sense of failure, don't they?
But I think the major criticism is the withdrawal of funding for early intervention and prevention and treatment, and the lack of understanding of therapeutic, you know, responses delivered from Aboriginal point of view. And I think there's complexities in the Northern Territory that aren't in any other state and territory. And unless you really build on what is Aboriginal and build a strong foundation, these issues can't be addressed. But when we did the Northern Territory inquiry, we saw so many conditions where Aboriginal people were treated less than. In your own country, as First People, the system was treated our people so bad.
And I want to pick up on that question of policy and responses and how we get a cohesive response to this a little later. I just want to stay with the idea that something you said, Yarraman, right at the start, where you said that this could have been any of your friends. I was watching with my son, and I watched, without him saying a word, I watched him doubt himself and doubt his country. I felt him lose his place in the world. I wanted to get a sense from you about how youth see yourselves in Australia as Indigenous youth. Where does that sense of alienation, of isolation come from? Where is the gap here between the aspirations of Indigenous youth and the broader society?
Yeah, so I work with young people a lot, and I'm really passionate about young people. And one of the major things I see is that we're not valued in society. You know, we're doing so many, you know, incredible things. And
what does that mean, not valued?
In the sense that, you know, we are essentially, like, our humanity is denied. We're not, you know, regarded as, you know, equal to non-Indigenous kids. I mean, like, you know, I went through school and, you know, there were constantly teachers, you know, just kind of indirectly telling me that I wasn't really, you know, valuable, that I wasn't really going to get anywhere, you know, in life. And I think that definitely that's an experience that a lot of Indigenous kids have. And, you know, over time that contributes to a lot of, you know, self-doubt and, you know, more intensely, you know, depression and, you know, really horrible mental health. And I think that, you know, it just can't, you know, continue like that, because we are many, many times more likely to commit suicide than non-Indigenous kids.
I think I read a statistic where 10 times more likely, almost 10 times more likely under the age of 14, and we see young people younger and younger taking their lives.
Yeah, and there's just, like, the way I see it, right now, a lot of my people, a lot of my friends even, we just don't see any hope. I mean, you know, we're talking about this stuff and, you know, we know what our communities need and we know what, you know, we need. We need, you know, mental health support. We need, you know, preventative measures to stop us, you know, from being incarcerated, not just, you know, being racially profiled and being, you know, straight up locked into a cell. I think that, you know, getting back to culture and letting us, you know, reclaim our identities as, you know, cultured, you know, sovereign peoples, I think that that's something that's really important. And it's something that has helped me also. Like, I've overcome a lot of mental health issues from just connecting to my own history and connecting to my own culture. And I think that really, if, you know, the governments and the authorities, if they want to help us, you know, they need to trust that we know what's best for our communities. We know that being connected to culture and letting us, you know, determine our own futures is one of the best ways that we can get back on track and, you know, stop all of these, you know, issues.
Vernon, do you see the same thing here, that what we hear from Yarraman there, a sense of being alienated and a sense of being judged negatively because you are Indigenous, a sense of your own self-worth being in question? Do you see the same things here in the kids that you work with?
I understand sisters, you know, different down south, a little bit more harder, different type
of... different history and a different relationship,
yeah,
and the numbers are different.
Absolutely. But up here, I got sisters sitting here beside me. I've been involved with football, rugby, everything. I guess I've seen all what this young lady's talking about, from suicide, the whole lot. To agree where all the families and the whole social system gets out of whack, and it really knocks the communities around. It's not one suicide affects the whole region, basically. But at the end of the day, I think the younger kids here, I think they've got a lot more hope.
Well, I see them. I see them here
and I think
running around with
more,
a sense of belonging, don't they? A real sense of themselves.
I think they've got a lot more opportunities, and there's, you know, like, there's hunting, there's bush, there's a supermarket outside here, you know, there's so many things for them to do. Where down, the poor kids down south, you know, they don't, it's just roads, traffic, they've got nowhere to really go, and I guess the only place they can go to is a park, and that's where the people are always looking for each, you know, our people down there and arresting them.
And, but like, that's a really interesting thing that Vernon raises there. If I look at the young kids here at Garma, the sense of belonging, the sense of themselves is really strong. But at what point do they also hit that wall? If you are still, indeed, Yarraman said, you know, there's a question of a connection to culture, but you have kids here who are very connected to culture, but still may hit that wall.
Our children in the Northern Territory, at least, should be classifying themselves as very lucky. We have natural resources right at our doorsteps. We can go, we can do hunting, it's not like going out to a big supermarket and buying.
You have language, you have ceremony.
We have our language, we have culture where we're trying to hang on to. And for me, I think, and I've gone, and I'm sure there's many parents or aunts or grandmothers who are scratching their heads and saying, where did we go wrong? We must ask ourselves.
Do you feel that? Do you feel that there's something that's gone wrong?
Sometimes it gets
structure?
To a point where you say, well, what did I do wrong? How do I grow you up wrong? What is it at home that we're not... What is in place with parents? You have parents that are drinking. You have parents that are doing all of these things, and domestic violence included, and all the things. Mm-hmm. That the children are growing up watching this. So I believe, for me, it starts at home. I'm not sure it's starting at home. Maybe bullying at the school, maybe a bit of racism. You're definitely racism. Our culture is too foreign for non-Indigenous people to accept. Simple. And because it's too foreign, they don't want to understand the Aboriginal people here.
So, Jackie, just hearing Bundock saying here, you have, it's so complex, isn't it? You have a dislocation, you have the challenges of a world outside your own, but you have within your own world decay and collapse and as Bundock said, a sense of failure in the home as well. How do we bring some sense to that? To that, what is a very complex mix?
Look, Stan, I've just recently heard, as you know, in our communities, it's usually the grannies who are taking on the children to raise them when their parents are unable to do so because of all kinds of reasons. One especially is around alcohol and drugs. And I heard this wonderful woman say to me, I must have done something wrong. Well, she really didn't. She hasn't done anything wrong. I think it has been very complex, as you say. And in terms of, she's doing her best to nurture that child and to bring that child up in the right way possible. But the forces of modern day society the day in which we live is far more complicated than certainly as I grew up as a child. You know, there was hardly any drinking, certainly no drugs. I mean, the drugs were around, of course, but the way they influenced your life was pretty negligible. Certainly ice, I'd never heard of ice or heroin, you know, in my day. So it has changed, and we know that cultures have to change. You know, we're not static, and we have to try to blend as much as we can, very much with our very ancient and true traditions in that sense. So it's very difficult, I think, as Aboriginal people in this country to be able to, you know, walk that fine line and to be able to live in those two worlds or three worlds or four worlds that quite often happens to us, and to be able to, you know, to walk that with pride and dignity. But we do, we see it here at Garma. It's been a wonderful place where people are so embedded in culture, so embedded in the trueness of being Aboriginal, you know. Yet, you know, the forces of outside world and what that has to bear can really strike at the heart of complicated issues that go to the very heart of why kids are acting up. And look, I've got to say this. I know that many of our children who are in detention centres are products of fetal alcohol syndrome. And that, of course, is quite a health issue that needs to be addressed. And, you know, sometimes kids don't know what is right and what is wrong when they act out. So, you know, I think there needs to be more assessments of them, and I hear that in detention centres they don't quite often do those. You know, the assessment of those children needs to be had to determine their health status and to be able to give them the proper treatment that they deserve. Like we have in mainstream, you know, the prison systems, we have our people with mental health issues, cognitive impairment, and yet they kept getting locked up. You know, they're not getting the treatment that they should be getting within those confines.
54% of the prison population are Indigenous. Now, does that come between the ages of 10 and 17? Does that come as a big surprise to you?
That's amazing. I can't believe that. 10-year-old kids. Oh, it's awful. And I think a lot of people don't know how big an issue it is and would be surprised to think that that's what's happening.
I don't know how we can all live with that statistic. Those boys, to me, presented with so much opportunity, they could be doing so much more than sitting in a prison.
I think it's pretty sad.
This is a special episode of Awaken. We're discussing the reactions to those horrifying images, of course, that have stunned the nation, the images of young people, Indigenous people, locked up in the Northern Territory, being beaten, being tear-gassed, being brutalised. And now, of course, the Prime Minister has called a Royal Commission, and already there are questions about just how effective that can be. We have a panel discussing these issues with us tonight. Vernon, I want to come to you with the reaction to the Royal Commission itself. Did anyone, you're involved here with North Australian Aboriginal Justice Agency?
Yeah.
Did anyone talk to you about setting up this Royal Commission and what you would like to see in it?
I had a briefing with, I can say this afternoon that I spoke with our senior PLO.
Was this before the Royal Commission was announced or after the terms of reference?
Well, no, it was after. Mm. Like we all know, it was done behind closed doors. A lot of people aren't happy with appointments and how it was done and about the numbers of particularly with Aboriginal people involved in it. I'm all for changing all that. But look, at the end of the day, it definitely needs to be cleaned right out, the whole system. And I think it needs to be reworked where they start working with employment agencies as well, so diversion reprograms when they come out. You can get all the stuff, get them going through care and get them going. But when they come out of the prisons, they've got to start engaging them back into the communities. Mm. And the best way they can do that is start by going up to all of these youth start. Work for the dole, or, it sounds a bit crazy, but an empty mind, is a devil's playground. Mm. So you need to get them straight away to don't let them go back into the wrong system, and that's the jail system. So I think if I was talking with these ladies here, I think our Aboriginal organisations have got to work harder within themselves, and a lot of these people in these organisations need to look at themselves too and look at how we can do things better, because we're a bit of the problem ourselves. There's strong people around and there's some good leadership everywhere. The government could do better by listening to us, but I think we're going to have to start taking it by getting in on this Royal Commission. And I know that the land councils in the Northern Territory, Naja and AmSant, will be in there. Mm.
But Bundak, how do you feel about the Royal Commission? There are questions about the choice of Brian Martin as commissioner. There are questions about whether he should be the commissioner alone, whether there should be Indigenous co-commissioner, perhaps two. How do you feel about the way it's being constructed, the accusations of lack of consultation, the terms of reference? What are your thoughts about how this Royal Commission is constructed?
I don't really care how it comes at the end result. Must be an end result where it does take board all of the things that are happening in our society today.
So all of the things?
All of the things that Indigenous people are facing in our society, whether it's in traditional or contemporary. Mm. Mainstream, Aboriginal, racism, violence, drug abuse, all of those things has to be health. Mm. One of the things that we've talked about for so many years, and it's always been just talk, because each time you try to get to a positive phase or stage, fundings are cut off. Indigenous fundings are cut off, so you can't apply for any particular funding to set up a rehabilitation centre in your own community, away from the main community centre, a little bit isolated, but not setting up something with the four walls. Mm. Don't want four walls. Don't want to send the kids into those sterile four walls, which creates, I think children quietly panics about things like that, and I'm sure parents quietly panic about children going into something that is an unknown territory for them. So I don't care how people come up
with the Royal Commission, you want to see the results.
As long as there's right people there, and long as they listen to the Indigenous people, and long as we from the community have an input into it, male, female.
Muriel, looking from Victoria and seeing similar things, what are you hoping to take away, or is there anything you can take away from the Royal Commission here in the Northern Territory?
Well, I think I really don't want us to, or the Northern Territory, to just think about the 22 that we're are currently in scope. I think you have to look at all young people in the Northern Territory, and if you look at the youthfulness, how many young people are in that population, what are the risks, how do we actually plan, how do we create a better system for Aboriginal young people in the Northern Territory. I think, you know, we talked before about cultural loads. There's been introduced cultures, you know, the drug culture, the alcohol culture, and, you know, modern cultures that have impacted on our people. And I think that our people have a cultural load that's heavier than anyone else's. We deal with so many funerals. We're dealing
and
with
a
racism.
History.
And
a history attached to this.
And, you know, and it's fighting, you know, a new culture. And we've got to get our young people to, you know, go back to being respectful. And respect was always the big thing in our communities. Respect for elders, respect for who you are, and respect for culture and language. We've got, you know, so many young people moving away from that, and I think it's really important that we understand the cultural loads, the impact of funerals, the young people. We've got so many men and women in prison. They're missing. They're usually the extended family that help raise children. So we don't have those. And so by not having those, stolen gens, people in prison, the juvenile justice, to have 10-year-olds locked up in a prison, it's just criminal. You cannot think a 10-year-old a criminal. It's unheard of. They're a child. They should be treated as a child, and it should be therapeutic. We should be managing that.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of what Muriel's saying there is positioning youth to accept more responsibility. The word respect was used, the ability to navigate these cultural challenges. How do you see youth being able to meet those challenges, and what youth impact would you like to see both in the Royal Commission and emerging out of the findings of the Royal Commission?
Definitely. I think that with the Royal Commission, what, you know, youth would really like to see is, you know, a really big input, because, you know, this is something that affects us, this is something that is, you know, about us. So definitely if there was, you know, a youth, you know, co-commissioner even, you know, on the Royal Commission, that would be, you know, really integral. And I think that definitely, you know, getting back to respect, getting back to, you know, community values, that's really, you know, really important, because I see a lot of youth today, like, not really respecting elders, not really, you know, respecting culture.
What's broken down there? If there's a lack of respect when I was growing up, and even now, if my father or my aunt, my grandmother would speak, I'd say nothing. And that respect was there, and it was part of our lives. What's happened if you are seeing youth not showing that level of respect to their own communities?
Yeah, I think that it's not necessarily, you know, like, our fault. There's a lot of, you know, things that we are, you know, trying to push through and trying to deal with at this time. You know, being a young Indigenous person, you know, at this time, I think it's really difficult, you know, to kind of deal with it. You know, I wake up in the morning and I kind of, you know, just have to think to myself, like, oh gosh, you know, another day, what's going to be in store for me?
It's a terrible thing to think when you're so young, and what you're saying, you know, I can understand. I can understand what you must feel as a young person, but our generations have been through that before. Parents, grandparents, great-grandparents. Is what's lacking in the youth now that we're seeing some of these issues?
I think that a lot of young people I know, you know, we're stepping up to the plate. We're not just, you know, letting the elders, you know, take on the fight for liberation and justice. You know, we're, you know, taking that on ourselves and, you know, making sure that, you know, our communities are being cared for. And I think that really we need to, you know, be listening to elders, be listening to our families, be listening, you know, to our hearts, and really, you know, connecting, because, you know, if we lose that connection, if we, you know, just go on our way and don't really, you know, keep our heads on straight, I think that things are only going to get worse. But definitely what I would like to see, I'm really, you know, passionate about mental health, and I think that definitely something that focuses around that for youth, something that, you know, ensures that our wellbeing in all ways is, you know, put in place. That's something important.
Jackie, every generation has its challenges, and they have different challenges, and there's enormous expectations and pressures on youth today that I didn't experience and you didn't experience. We had our own issues. What do you see, and I don't this be sort of, you know, the youth of today, you know, or in our day, but do you see that too? Do you see a lack of respect? Does it sadden you when you hear Yarraman say she wakes up and thinks, how do I even go on?
Yes, and as Yarraman's speaking, you know, I think it happened to every Aboriginal person on this panel, Stan, and including you two, where we woke up, and I used to wake up feeling every day, I was feeling defensive about what is going to happen to me today because I am an Aboriginal woman.
And waiting for that moment when
and
it's
waiting,
challenged or the comment.
And the, waiting, yes, and it would inevitably come, you know. And I'd think, oh, well, that made me a stronger person, of course, and, you know, built up my defences around it. But we have such a similar, well, we have the same history and such a similar experience in terms of growing up Aboriginal in this country. You know, a country where we are not free of violence. Mm. You know, we have still freedoms to even obtain.
And an inheritance of sadness and grief.
Yes. And that transgenerational trauma that, you know, passes down through the generations, you know, we have to break that at some level. And healing is so important within our communities. And, you know, we have the Aboriginal Healing Foundation. I'm on a campaign called Change the Record, which is about the high incarceration rates of our people in prison and family and domestic violence. It's a national congress, you know, we lend our weight to that very important campaign. We have our non-Indigenous partners within that too, to just try to stem back, you know, the tide. But, you know, it is getting worse. Incarceration in this country is
and we
really
know that, don't
worse.
We, Muriel? It is getting worse. That's statistical fact.
Yeah. I mean, Yarraman was really right about young people, but the system has a responsibility to deliver on our rights. As Aboriginal people, we have rights before every system. If young people are in crisis, we should have a system. If young people need housing, they should get housing. Every person in Australia has a right. For some reason, Aboriginal people get second-rate service before the service system. And particularly in the Northern Territory, you should have appropriate housing, you should get the appropriate support services, criminal justice, juvenile justice. We have rights before that system. And I think that what you're seeing is an absolute failure to address the rights, particularly of children, in the Northern Territory. The absence of prevention programs, the pulling out and the blaming game. It's the Commonwealth. The Commonwealth needs to do more. It's all about the Commonwealth.
And Bunduk, you hear this blame game, don't you, time and time again. And what is particular about the Northern Territory, Muriel identified there, the lack of rights, of fundamental rights, of access to fundamental things that we should all expect in society. What is particular about the failing of that in the Northern Territory?
When you look back to how the intervention came about, that was a major blow to all Indigenous communities in Northern Territory.
And again, that was a response to a crisis. And that
was a response to a crisis. And you have samples in Aboriginal communities which have been established from ground, Indigenous organisations who's been so proud of creating something to sustain the people, to employ people, and so forth. The delivery of services and the lack of acknowledgement of Indigenous peoples always fighting for the rights of employment, the rights of all of the necessary things under the civil rights, all of those things as people, labour, workers, for your community is never given. We always have to try harder, neck harder. harder, justify our existence, you know, harder, prove to the system of who we are, identify ourselves time and time and time over again. So many times that sometimes you just want to give up and walk away.
So we got to look at this as a systemic thing. You can't just fix the prisons without fixing the whole system, you know?
Do you think the system really needs to be reworked?
Yeah, definitely.
The kids, they're wayward, they've probably had bad upbringing and that. They need help. They don't need to be shattered and smashed around more.
Definitely more monitoring of the systems that are in place because, yeah, that's out of control at the moment.
A Royal Commission would definitely help the issue, but whether it'll solve it, it's not going to give us all the answers.
I think some good will come out of it, which is positive, but it's probably a bit late.
This is a special edition of Awaken. We're looking at the issue of youth incarceration in the Northern Territory very much in the spotlight now, and what may come out of a Royal Commission, but clearly there are other issues here and criticism coming from the rest of the community as well about what Indigenous people and Indigenous organisations themselves are doing about that. We're discussing these issues with our panel tonight. Jackie, I want to come to you and let me play devil's advocate for a moment. I've read these comments in newspapers. I've heard some of the commentary in our media. These kids put themselves there. These kids have committed crimes. They deserve to be punished for the crimes that they commit. The parents are to blame. The communities are to blame. We do enough for Indigenous people. We spend enough money on Indigenous people. These are the comments we hear. How do we respond to that?
Well, as we know, there's about $34 billion.
Every year.
Every year.
Either directly or indirectly, not all of it directly.
Mm-hmm. Spent on Aboriginal affairs. $34 billion, Stan. I mean, it's scandalous.
So where is it going? That's
yes, and what developments, what outcomes have we got on the ground? You know, we should seriously be asking those questions, and how much it costs to keep children in detention and people locked up in jails. I mean, if we took that out of the equation, you know, I'm sure that'd be worth a few billion, you know, at least.
What one of the things you've been talking about in Congress, you've had your own struggles with government and relationship with government, yes. And the things you're talking about now is the need to create an Indigenous Affairs Department to reclaim these issues.
That yes.
Clearly there is not the connection between the money that's spent and the outcome on the ground.
And I must say that a lot of that money is spent on white bureaucrats in the system, which is clearly being evidenced. But certainly we're calling on an own department, our separate department, headed by a senior cabinet minister, because, you know, we're a little bit tired of, you know, being pushed around all the time and nothing comes to us. Yes, it's true that National Congress, we're embarking on resetting the relationship. And here at Garma, we've heard some of our main leaders, you know, tell us that they've been working on this relationship for years and years and years and saying the same old things. And quite frankly, we get very tired of saying the same old things, you know. People, I'm sure, Bunduk and certainly Muriel, who I know very well, have been saying the kind of things in child protection and domestic violence and so forth. But we just want to be heard. So we're really asking the Prime Minister of this country to really have a look at the way in which Aboriginal affairs is addressed and to walk with us to have a relationship. We don't have that relationship at the moment with the government. We really do need to start talking and having open-mindedness and sitting down and saying, enough is enough. What can we do?
Muriel, one of the issues that I've seen commented on in recent days after all of this focus on the situation in the Northern Territory is the question of child protection. The number of children that are being removed from homes, which is higher now than it's ever been, has increased, I think, 400% since the Bringing Them Home report.
Yep, and 97% in the Northern Territory, so the numbers have gone up to 1,500.
One of the criticisms I've heard, though, is people saying this idea of keeping children in Aboriginal communities or with Aboriginal families is failing, and that children should be taken away at the first sign of danger and given to non-Indigenous families. This is the type of criticism that's being directed. How do we respond to that criticism when the reality is we are seeing our own parents, as Bundaka said, parents failing to look after their own children?
The thing is that we don't have the housing issues. The housing is a big issue in the Northern Territory. If you don't have the capacity, if you've got 20 and 30 people living in a house, how can you keep children safe? If you're a young mum having a baby and you want to get a parent, you want to keep your child, but you can't keep them safe because you don't have a house or a home.
A critic would say, take the child away, the child to a non-Indigenous parent
but
or a non-Indigenous carer.
But the reality is the usefulness of our population. We don't have enough Aboriginal carers. We know that Aboriginal children do better in Aboriginal community. Why do you think so many kids end up in juvenile justice? Because they have been taken away.
But why do we not have enough Indigenous carers? Is there a problem in the way that it is framed, that they don't feel confident working in the system as it's currently constructed?
That is the real issue in the Northern Territory. You will not remove a child that's living in community and living... If a child is living in a house with 20 other people, they are viewed as safe. But when we go to place a child, we can't put them into a house because they don't fit the criteria of a normal house. So the criteria for placing is much... But there's complexities here that we have never, ever seen. You know, you can't place children with skin name, different moieties. There are complications here in the Northern Territory, but that doesn't mean that you don't work at... The best solution is when Aboriginal people work with Aboriginal families to keep kids in homes.
And Vernon, where are you seeing that failure with child protection? Are there cases, as we've heard, where children just need to be removed from that situation?
Nadja is, we talk about this a lot. We see it as another form of, the stolen generation, but it's happening at the kids' level. And you know, that's shocking. But listen, I just want to go back, Stan, to you were saying, how can we fix some of these problems? All this money, too, there was talking about money, where it's all going. What you have to do is take the special measures off. Because ever since the special measures came into the Northern Territory, that gave the Northern Territory government free rein to do what they wanted.
And just
people didn't really see this.
To explain to people the special measures.
Well, the special measures were put in place, and it took away all our rights. Everyone had no bargaining power. They put it in. It was a special measure. That took away all our rights. So we went up to Geneva. We went everywhere right across the world. We've tackled everyone, the Australian government, the whole lot. It's wrong what they've done, but what I'm trying to get at in the Northern Territory, and what it's done, we talked about where all this money is. It's setting up all these different things now that we're talking about out of the special measures. Oh, we have to have these childcare, we have to have all this, we have to have all this
so
stuff you're
talking
about.
Layers and layers
and all these people.
Bureaucracy.
They were created by the special intervention. It also gave the... I don't want to be political, but it gave powers to the law enforcement way beyond special measures. Mm. If you can see what I'm saying there, it's a real vicious thing.
We gave away
our rights to be trampled on.
I do hear what you're saying, Bundaka. Do you see this as being a part of the problem here is that communities themselves feel disempowered by intervention, by special measures, that the community's ability to respond to that is taken away by the imposition of a top-down approach?
Disempowerment of any persons, if you're a human being, and you know as a human being you have a right to exist, whether you belong to this culture over here or you come from this, you have a language, but the way the Indigenous people in Australia has been treated goes back to how they were treating Indigenous people back then. And this reintroducing of stolen generation emerges again. And our children are being taken, being brought up by non-Indigenous for the sake of what they believe parents or families are not doing in safety of that child. They get taken in the process they take that child's right as an Aboriginal person, right as a cultural child, right as a language speaking child, and disconnect them from family. The system is totally wrong.
What are we're hearing a lot tonight, Yarram, and I want to get your thoughts as a young person. I've spoken about this in recent times, others have spoken about it, that to try to look at these things, we need to look at them as part of our history. That the history of dispossession, the history of marginalisation, impoverishment, the history of policy failure can't be separated from what we saw on our television screens this week. As a young person, how do you feel about the way that our history is talked about? How do you feel about the way that we still can't discuss invasion versus settlement or the frontier wars? What impact does that 200 years of history have on your life as a young Indigenous person?
In my life, I think about it, you know, all the time that, you know, we've been dealing with, you know, 200 plus years of colonialism and anti-black racism. And when you consider that, that creates for a very, you know, a crisis point that we're in. I think that, you know, all throughout school, I was taught that, you know, unless I took an elective subject where we actually, you know, could choose to learn about Indigenous histories or choose to be ignorant, in general history we were taught that, you know, Captain Cook came along, that he settled this continent, that there was a bit of, you know, a bit of violence, and after that everything was all fine and dandy, and we all know that that's not true at all. You know, there was, you know, massacres, there was genocide, there was, you know, the horrible mistreatment of our people, of our land, of our culture, of our language, of our identities, and ultimately our humanities. You know, we weren't, and we still aren't, regarded as people in this
country. So how does that impact on you now? A lot of people would say, and they've said it to me, they've said it to all of us here at different times, get over it. Mm. It's in the past. It's just our history. It happened everywhere.
Yeah.
What do you say to that? Should we be trapped in our history, and how do we free ourselves from that history?
I think it's really important to remember that what has happened in the past is still happening today, and it has a massive impact on our experiences and our, you know, situation today. Obviously, you know, with the stolen generations, that is still happening. Yes, it happened in the past, but it's still happening now. And when you kind of, you know, get back at criticism like that, I think that, you know, a lot of the issues that are happening, they've just continued in new ways. They've, you know, these people have just found new ways of, you know, to harm us and to degrade us as, you know, cultured, you know, as, you know, cultured people. I think, for me, I just, as I was saying before, I wake up and I think, what's in store for me today? And I think the only thing that gets me through is knowing that I have a culture and knowing that, you know, I am still, you know, a person, that I'm absolutely valid.
Yeah, and you have a long life ahead of you, so don't start out thinking that you have no future, because you do. You do have a future. Jackie, is there a need for a Truth and Reconciliation Commission? We are in the process of looking at recognition. There is discussion about treaty in Victoria and discussion about potentially treaty at a national level. How do we position recognition or treaty or these things in light of our history? Is there a need for a process before we even get to that point?
I think so, Stan. In fact, I'm a great supporter of the truth and reconciliation or justice.
Truth and justice, yeah.
Yeah, Truth and Justice Commission. You know, we've seen great strides through the Council for Aboriginal Reconciliation. However, it didn't have the mandate that, you know, the South African Truth and Reconciliation Commission did. So it would be great to see something like that in our country, because, you know, we still haven't had that discussion. You know, we haven't had the dialogue or the conversation around all this stuff that we talk about tonight, particularly about our history and our future and how each and every one of us can be part of that future. And, you know, I have white fellows saying to me quite often, and here in Garma, what can I do to help?
You know, I hear that all the time.
You hear that all the time, and I'm sure that we all do.
They want to be part of the solution. Muriel, you're involved in Victoria in treaty discussion. Mm-hmm. Again, people will say, what difference would a treaty make? To a kid in a prison cell, to a kid committing suicide, to these intractable socioeconomic problems, what difference would a treaty make?
Well, I
I think that, you know, it's recognition of a history that we belong to this country and that what happened to Aboriginal people was wrong. But it also addresses that real issue of poverty. I mean, Aboriginal people were so in the poverty cycle. And if we didn't have a footprint in the disadvantage, if we weren't overrepresented in in the prisons, would we have a footprint in Australia? So what is our footprint? And if we aren't recognised as the First Peoples, if we don't have access to the land and connection to our spirituality, I mean, we come up here to Garma and we see the culture, and then I go back to Victoria and I think, you know, how do we build that back into invaded?
I feel the same thing. I feel great. Yeah. Pride here, and I feel the sadness, because when I go home, we don't have this. We can't say we have a claim on our land and the ability to live our lives as the people have here. But Vernon, for you, if you look at this, how do you position this in our history? And you know, again, people would say in the Northern Territory there are rights. There are rights of native title. There are various forms of land tenure. There are rights here, and still we're seeing socioeconomic problems, justice problems, incarceration issues, even where rights exist.
Yeah, look, it's gone back from day one, from when we first colonised. But look, rights doesn't mean it's right.
No.
Because at the end of the day, the systems around all the rights could be wrong. And to get the right people in the right spots and juggle to get it right is a bit of, it's a game we've been playing all our life. So I think it's a good question you put there, because we got sea rights here, we got land rights, and we got a lot of freedom, in a sense, and the kids basically have got a lot more freedom than the kids down south, and less things that, like, the drugs are different. We've got petrol sniffing, carver, things, affect people in different ways. And down south, and in Darwin, they've got the ice and all these new designer drugs. And it's very hard to say what's right or wrong. And some rights are good, but I don't know. It's a tough one. I still think it comes back to the system. I just think in the Northern Territory, look, in the Northern Territory, you can walk around in the Northern Territory and get arrested just for being a black fella, basically. And you can get locked up for 4 hours without paperless arrest. It's all these rules that have brought I'm going back to the intervention, but it has caused a draconian state or a territory, because it was open slather and people haven't seen this, but now it's all out.
Jackie, is there a need for a body, the ability, and Congress is trying to right that relationship now, but when you have such disparate issues right across the country, different groups facing different challenges, where is that voice? Where is that national voice to speak at a national level?
Well, Congress is equipped to do that, Stan. Quite clearly, we have been elected by our people and we have the mandate to do so. As you know, we have a male and a female co-chair, and we are split right through 50-50% gender equity, which we are very proud of, because we know that women can have a voice now through Congress. Our country is diverse. Certainly what happens for me in Brisbane doesn't necessarily apply for up here in Garma. It is complex, but we are really calling on unity for our people, because we need that right now, because our country is in crisis.
Bundaka, I want to finish with you as someone from this land, as someone who has seen children pass through Don Dale, who have seen the struggle to hold your youth together. For those boys that you saw on our television screens, for those boys who are in these institutions right now and wondering about their lives and their future, if you could speak to them, what's the message you would send them?
The message for me, and
boys and girls,
hopefully
of course, as well,
on behalf of the Indigenous families in Northern Territory. But I also would like to say I believe it's the non-Indigenous children in there as well.
Mm.
And
all
in both,
children,
in
male,
both,
female,
both jails,
non-Indigenous, Indigenous. Yeah,
yeah, both jails in the juvenile detention centre and the main detention centre. The adults might be looked at differently because they're an adult and people say, oh, you know, they're adults. They did what they did because they were an adult. But there's still issues of mental health, physical health when they come out. Children is different. But both my young and old, male, female, for as an Indigenous person coming from a traditional background and having to have heard the panel of the different rolling, the system rolling over of our rights, our disacknowledgements of our colour, of introductions of drug and alcohol, of through those, the domestic violence are worse, the violence in our society is getting bigger because of fuel-injected problems in our families and so forth, and sometimes it gets uncontrollable. Mm. But I just wish that one day, not having to have just talked so much about setting a centre up where we can deliver services, education, on the job training if they're to be working, all of the things necessary to have the perpetrators or the people, the lawbreakers, if you like, at home, under the eyes of the system, family, whatever, and making it easy for our people to access visits, because it's costly going to Darwin, and not many Aboriginal people have enough money to go visit each time. Yeah. I was fortunate enough at one point, I sat on so many different boards, and I were able to extend my days over, 2 or 3 days over, to make sure I visited, and I did that for the last 20 odd years, literally. Mm. Not many families can do that. Mm. So bring that home where families can visit, where families can have a watchful eye. If there's a traditional disciplinary process, let it happen. Yeah. If there's a mainstream disciplinary, let it happen.
Yeah.
But let it happen at home.
And hopefully bring the children home. That's what we all hope. Thank you very much for all being part of the panel tonight. It's a difficult subject. There are no easy answers here. We can only hope that we won't continue to see the images that we've seen on our screen this week. Thank you for watching this special episode of Awaken, coming to you from the Garma Festival in what has been a very tough week for our country and our people.